I would request you all. Now I would request you all to maintain a 1 minute silence for all those who lost their lives during this pandemic.
I think it's fine. We shall proceed with the event. I would request team code 02 to please present their paper and be ready. Please proceed, team code 02. Am I audible?
Hi. Yes, you're audible. Okay. I can't share my screen. Host disable participant screen sharing.
Just a second. Akshat, kindly do the same. You must have got the request.
No.
I haven't got the request.
Team code 02, can you please request it?
Check your, I can't see that.
Akshat, can you please make me the host?
Yes. I've done it.
Sakshi, is it now accessible?
Any issues?
So is it visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay. Hi, everyone. A very good afternoon to one and all who is present out here. I'm Sakshi Dev. I'm a final year law student pursuing my BBLLB from DME Law School. So the topic which I have decided to give my presentation is impact of COVID-19 on education. The theme is same for all. So the sub theme is impact of COVID-19 on education. So why I have decided to give my presentation on this particular topic is because education sector has been majorly affected from past 1.5 years. Not only the school students, not only the college students, even the school teachers and college professors have suffered a lot. So keeping all the negative impacts and all the positive impacts in my mind, I have made my research paper and my presentation. So before I'll just proceed to my sub theme, let us just first give a glimpse on right to clean environment. So environment and life, they both are interrelated. So for leading a quality life, a clean and a healthy environment is indispensable. A person will remain healthy as soon as he is provided with the fresh air to breathe, clean water to drink, and other basic requirements. So in order to live a dignified and healthy life, it is very important for each and every person to be surrounded by a clean environment. So basically in previous years, environment was never a priority. So by keeping in all the things that environment related health issues, environment related diseases, now this right is an emerging concept and hotly debated in the human rights arena. Healthy environment is an essential aspect of the right to life and human beings, but also for the animals on the planet, and the violation of which is the right to healthy environment. If anybody wants to violate this right, so ultimately it is a violation of the basic right to life. So Article 21 of the Indian Constitution is specifically states that no person shall be deprived of a person. No person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedures established by law. Article 21 is one of the most important article of the Constitution, which consists of every right. If I talk about right to privacy, right to life, live in relationship and whatnot. So Article 21 is one of the most important article of Constitution of India. So the Supreme Court expanded this negative right in two ways. Firstly, any law affecting personal liberty should be reasonable, fair and just. Secondly, the court recognized several unarticulated liberties that were implied by Article 21. It is by this second method that the Supreme Court interpreted the right to life and personal liberty to include the right to a clean environment. So now my main sub-theme was impact of COVID-19 on education. So as we all know, the pandemic COVID-19 has spread over the whole world and compelled the human society to maintain social distance. And I think it is one of the best ideas. It has significantly disrupted the education sector, which is a critical detriment of a country's economic future. February 11, 2020, the World Health Organization proposed an official name of the virus as COVID, acronym for Coronavirus Disease 2019. It was first identified in Wuhan, China on December 31st, 2019. First death by COVID-19 was the 61-year-old man in Wuhan, China, 2020. WHO declared COVID-19 as a pandemic on 2020. The first case of the COVID-19 pandemic reported on 30th January 2020 in the state of Kerala, and the affected had a travel history from Wuhan, China. After observing the coronavirus pandemic situation, the WHO advised to maintain social distancing as the first prevention step. So every country started the action of lockdown to separate the contaminated people or those people who have mild symptoms, who have severe symptoms. The education sector, including schools, colleges, and universities, they all have been closed. So I still remember when I stepped into fourth year, all the teachers were nervous because they have no idea, senior teachers, I'm talking about senior teachers, because they have no idea how to use Google Meet link, how to create Google Meet link, how to give Zoom link to these students, how difficult it was for them. Still, they have made several video lectures for their students. They have made several presentations. They have made Word documents. They have made MCQs for their students. They have done so much hard work. And I seriously want to say thanks to all my DME faculty members and DME teachers for giving and guiding us even through an online mode. Thank you so much. So classes suspended and all the examinations of school, colleges and universities, including entrance test, they all were postponed indefinitely. So many college students who all are in their final year, I know how difficult it is for them. Even I am a final year student. I know how difficult it will be for me when I just step into the practical world. I know there is no job. I know they have no resources. So I know how difficult it will be for me when I step into the practical world. So I'm thinking whether I should pursue my master's, whether I should go for the practical world or not. It is very difficult for me to think about that. So the lockdown destroyed the schedules of every student. School students are enjoying.
So you don't feel yourself like challenging the world and to come out and challenge everybody and to seek what is required for you and what is fit for you.
As in what aspect, sir?
No, you told that, right? Like it will be difficult for you to get job.
Yes, sir.
Like all those
things.
Yes,
sir.
I don't think that people who are talented and people who are more, who deserve what they want.
Yes, sir.
They can face the challenges and they can get anything what they want. What is your...
Yes, sir. Sir, actually, I was very confused when I was in fourth year whether I should go for the master's or I just step into the practical world. But right now, I'm just making
what
my mind that I should...
What is practical world for you?
Practical world is as in like right now, I'm just focusing on my theoretical knowledge and I'm just making myself and learning all the things theoretically, right? And it is very difficult for me to learn
my
things
practically.
My internships
are not practical?
No, online internships are not that much of... useful because
don't
they are giving
offline,
us research
offline world has made everything much easier than what we used to do it practically.
Yeah, I know, sir. In offline mode, the main advantage was that we used to interact with associates, we used to interact with senior associate, they guide us about drafting skills, we used to, you know, travel to a court.
Let's come on the topic, right? Let's come on the topic. Yeah, human rights.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah, so where was I? Initially, the educators and the students were quite confused and didn't understand how to cope up with the situation of this sudden crisis that compelled closure of the educational activities. But later, on all realized that all lockdown has taught so many lessons to manage with the emergence of such pandemics. Thus, COVID created many challenges and opportunities for the educational institutes to strengthen their infrastructure. The lockdown has given them a ray of hope to the teachers and to the students to continue their educational activities through online. The teachers assigned...
Tell me one thing.
Yes, sir.
What do you feel what human rights is and how this pandemic has given more importance to human rights?
As in human rights?
Yes. What is human rights?
Human right is a basic right that everyone should be aware about that. And if that right is violating, so we have to fight for this because it is basic right to life. Right to basic environment comes under the right to life.
Is human rights absolute?
Yeah, it is an absolute.
No, it is not absolute.
Okay, sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
And is fundamental rights absolute?
Fundamental right, it can be, yes sir, it is an absolute.
It is also not absolute.
What is an absolute according to...
what is an absolute right? What do you understand by what is absolute right?
According to me, I think if right is infringed, so we can go to the court and we can demand for the remedies. In my mind, I thought that absolute is that. But I don't know about the law perspective.
Okay, fine. Continue.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the Government of India education initiatives during COVID-19. So on March 16, 2020, the Union Government declared a nationwide lockdown of all the educational institutes. The Central Board of Secondary Education, CBSE, has postponed all the secondary and higher secondary school examination in India until March 18, 2020. CBSE issued revised guidelines for examination centers to conduct exams within a minimum distance of one of the students should be divided into separate rooms accordingly. Similarly, due to the outbreak of COVID-19, the majority of state government and other educational boards postponed examination. Are you in favor of offline examinations or not? I'm in the favor of the examination, whether it will conduct online or offline, because ultimately it will impact on the life of the students. Government has nothing to do with
that. But my question is very much specific. I am asking,
yes, sir.
Are you in favor of offline
examination? Yes. Yes, sir.
Then why students are writing to the court that...
I am not into that, sir. Students. I'm talking about myself and I am in favor
of... How come it is important, right? How come you feel that the offline examinations are important?
Sir, exams are very important. Ultimately, it will destroy your life. It will, if you are not ready for the exam, it will ultimately impact on your life. If you're not studying anything, if you're not ready for the exam, so ultimately it is the loss of yours. And not the government, not the college authorities are all suffered because of this.
Okay,
students will ultimately...
Proceed.
Effect, yeah.
Yes. When is the International Human Rights Day?
The International Human Rights Day?
Yes.
I have no idea. International Human Rights Day.
December. A paper on human rights.
Human rights. International Human Rights Day, sir. I have no idea.
Proceed.
December, maybe.
10th December.
10th December. 10th December.
Yes. You cannot guess 10th. When you are presenting a paper.
Okay.
Come on.
Okay, next. Sir. If I have mentioned about the International Human Rights Day, so I could tell that, but I have not read that. So that's why.
Next.
But I guessed my month right, sir. As a result, the governmental digital India version is emerging as a critical tool for resolving the current crisis caused by COVID-19. Right now, all the apps, Zoom, Google Meet, Link, they all are very essential for all the people right now. So secondary schooling, what impact on the secondary schooling? due to COVID-19. So the Diksha portal includes curriculum-aligned e-learning content for students, teachers, such as video lessons, worksheets, textbooks, and the assessments. More than 250 teachers who teach in multiple languages created the content under the supervision of its National Board of Education and NCERT. First one is E-Pathshala and second one is N-R-O-E-R. So NCERT is E-Pathshala.
What is the full form of N-C-E-R-T?
N-C-E-R-T. N-C-E-R-T.
Just not obvious thing, things will work. Right. Yes, next.
I knew the full form, sir, national.
It's okay, it's okay.
N-C-E-R-T. Okay. Yeah. So, where was I? Sir, you're interrupting me in between, so I'm confused whether I should... I don't know from where I have to start. Okay. National Repository of Open Educational Resources. This portal offers a variety of resources in multiple languages for students and teachers, including books, interactive modules, and videos, as well as a variety of STEM-based games. Next is higher education, how it is impacting to the post-graduation student. So there is one app that is Swayam. It is a national online education platform that offers 1900 courses in subjects ranging from high school, 9th to 12th to higher education, undergraduate and postgraduate programs, including engineering, humanities and social sciences, law and management. Second is Swayam Prabha. It has 32 DTH TV channels that broadcast educational content 24 hours a day. 7 days a week, these channels can be accessed from anywhere in the country by using a DD-free dish setup box and antenna. Postgraduate students can use EPG Pathshala. During the lockout, postgraduate students can use this portal to access ebooks, online classes, any study materials. The value of this platform is that students can use these resources without having to use the internet for the whole day. Now the positive impact. Positive impact is good for those students who are utilizing this situation from the top, from starting from past 1.5 years. People are indulge themselves into the certificate course, in online courses. They are doing online internships. So this has a very positive impact to the college students' life. So despite the fact that the outbreak of COVID-19 has had many negative effects on education, it has some positive impacts also. The transition to the blended learning, learning management system use has increased the transformation of a teacher to a performer, increased the soft copies of learning materials, improved collaboration, increased use of online meeting, enhanced digital literacy, improved use of electronic media for knowledge sharing, global exposure, enhanced time management, demand for open and distant learning. And the negative impacts, increased responsibility of parents to guide their wards. Nutritional loss as a result of school closure, because so many schools, they have that that they will give midday meal to their school students. So because of that, nutritional loss as a result of school closures, access to the technological ward, access to worldwide education, fees for school and colleges have been delayed, educational activity hampered, and impact on jobs. And because of this, from past 1.5 years, I have read so many cases of suicide. So many people have taken their life because they don't have job. They think that there is no job opportunities left for them, so they take their life. And I'm just thinking about those family where the breadwinner of the family have taken their life just because he or she is suffering from COVID, or he's not into that mind that whether he will get job in future or not. So some suggestions from my side, that immediate action is required to mitigate the effects of the pandemic on job opportunities, internship programs, and research projects. Indian traditional knowledge is well known around the world for its scientific innovations, values, and benefits in developing sustainable technologies and medicines. And this knowledge system in various fields should be integrated with the modern mainstream higher education system. Access to technology and the internet is an urgent requirement in today's world. As a result, digital capabilities and necessary infrastructure must reach the most remote and impoverished communities to allow students to continue their education during pandemic. Now the conclusion. So the COVID-19 has had a significant impact on India's education sector. Despite the fact that it has created numerous challenges, opportunities are evolving as well. To deal COVID-19 crisis, the Indian government and educational stakeholders have investigated the possibility of ODL through the use of various digital technologies. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay. So my the final question would be, yes, you're there. Right?
Yes, sir.
What is your suggestion to improve the digital learning?
Sir, according to my opinion, I am enjoying a lot because studying in online mode, I am like enjoying this platform because professors are giving us every video lectures. So I think that much idea that how to improve the digital. They can make that app. Every college make their, you know, several app, like our college has Coalpole. So, every college can make that different app or alternate app where they can give every videos, every PPTs to their students to guide them. Or, thank you, sir.
Great.
Thank you, Sakshi, for your presentation. It was nice, I think. We shall proceed. Sir, can we proceed for the next participant?
Yeah.
I would request team 419 to please start their presentation. Am I audible to him?
Yes. 19, right?
Yes. Please start.
Am I audible?
Yes, perfectly audible. Please start. Can you please increase can you increase the volume?
You're not audible properly.
Am I audible now?
Sir, is he audible to you?
Am I audible?
Yeah, no, it's fine.
Yes, yes. Is it visible?
Yeah, it is.
Thank you so much. My name is Karthikeya Methani. I'm a fourth year BBA LLB student from Delhi Metropolitan Education, Noida. And I have picked my topic as impact of COVID-19 on common people and business entities. And while the course of discussing this research, we will also establish how the impact of common people and business entities is very much interrelated to one another. So firstly, beginning with the introduction, if we look into the brief timeline of COVID-19 in India, it started from March 2020, and currently we are dealing with the second wave of COVID-19. In the introduction part, we have dealt with the overall analysis. And the overall analysis has been done in two facets. Firstly, that is the social impact, and secondly, the economical impact, that is the impact on business entities and how they are both interrelated to one another. Further, we'll be specifically focusing on social ramifications of COVID-19. In brief, we'll be discussing the migrant crisis that we dealt with during the initial days of the lockdown, the job losses, and the law and order situation. Further, we'll be dealing with the ramifications of COVID-19 on businesses, specifically the impact on MSMEs, stock market, and the rising opportunities which we have witnessed on the site. So moving on to the objectives and research methodology, the main objective of this research is to analyze the overall impact of COVID-19 on the social economic fabric of India and providing some suggestions for the way ahead. Certainly, the government has taken certain measures over the period of time. We'll be focusing on them as well, and we'll try to do a critical analysis of the steps that the government has taken and what the future possibilities could possibly be. The research methodology is exploratory in nature. This research paper is exploratory, and it is mainly it is a qualitative analysis of all the information that we have collected from various resources. We will not be focusing much on quantitative data. However, in certain situations, to focus on a certain fact, there might be some quantitative data available, but we'll be primarily focusing on qualitative analysis of the information we have gathered from various resources. So now we move on to the social ramifications of COVID-19 pandemic. If you recall correctly, since the beginning of the lockdown situation, there were certain aspects about the social structure of India that was more or less ignored by the union as well as the state governments, which gave rise to a massive migrant crisis, which led to the deaths of hundreds of migrant workers, job loss of millions of migrant workers, without a proper policy framework of ensuring that they reach their home, that they reach their homes, and a safety for their employment and incomes. Further, there were job losses and loss of earnings. If we discuss further into the job losses aspect, we focus on primarily the lower income group, the lower middle income group, and the middle income group, which saw a huge losses in terms of job in different sectors. Specifically, if we talk about the tourism and travel sector, the hotel industry, the restaurant business, these were the few sectors which saw a heavy decline due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And a recent study, which we have referred in further research as well, stated that in the national capital region of Delhi, there has been a decline of around 20,000 rupees per annum amongst the residents, which is a decline which the national capital region has saw after nearly 10 years. The last decline in the income of residents was seen in during the 2008 recession, and after that, this is the time when we are witnessing a fall in income and earnings of the residents of the National Capital Region of Delhi. Now, another point of study is the law and order situation and the issues relating to it, which arose during the COVID-19 pandemic situation and the lockdown, focusing on the aspects of police brutality. And the systematic mismanagement of the migrant workers and their absolutely immoral persecution under Disaster Management Act. So, for discussing more about the social ramifications in the research, we have addressed this mismanagement and unpreparedness of the union as well as the state governments, which was also eventually addressed by the Supreme Court of India in its when it took the suo motu cognizance and ordered and released several orders in favor of the migrant workers, job losses, and the interest of common people, directing both the union and state governments to take adequate measures and form policies for the benefit of the common people and a good in the longer run. As we have discussed about the migrant workers, the primary issues that were faced initially were that they were seen firstly as the carriers of the virus, not only in their place of work, but also when they reached their homes after facing all those hardships, when they reached their home, they were again seen as carriers of the virus in their hometowns as well. We witnessed migrant deaths. There is no officially verified government data on how many migrant deaths were there during the COVID-19 pandemic and the lockdown situation. But there are several reports from many private journals which suggest that at least 800 to 1,000 people in the migrant worker category have lost their lives moving from their place of work to their hometowns. Lastly, we need to discuss about the government steps, which came a little too late, which included arranging bus and train facilities for the migrant workers to reach their hometowns, arranging food and water services for free of cost, and arranging health screening when they reach their hometowns in different states. So they cannot be labeled primarily as the carriers of virus, and if there is an issue, it can be addressed beforehand only. Then we move on to the loss of jobs and earnings. As we discussed before as well, the National Capital Region of Delhi saw a decline in the income of the residents and overall fall in the GDP, including not just the capital region but the entire GDP of India, which saw a heavy decline in the year 2020. However, by the end of 2020, as reported by the United Nations as well, India was recovering economically from the COVID-19 pandemic, the first wave. But of course, as we are witnessing right now, the second wave has created a loss which might take years for us to recover from. There was a cut down in different sectors. I have slightly mentioned about this before as well, and the cut down was firstly witnessed massively in the travel and tourism industry, which saw a job loss of around 5 million people, according to various sources. Job loss of 5 million people, following by the restaurant and the hotel services, which also saw many outlets and hotels being closed due to zero bookings. There was one more aspect, which was one more aspect that a few sectors also saw a rise in the job offerings, which were primarily the IT sector, in the area of data privacy, cybercrime, etc., and the health sector, of course, because it is self-explanatory. They needed more set of hands to deal with the crisis. So the health sector also saw a rise in job offerings. The law and order situation is firstly, of course, when we talk about law and order situation, we must point at the police brutality that took place during the lockdown period. And the Supreme Court, in its order dated June 12th, when it took the suo motu cognizance about the migrant worker case, also ordered that all the cases that have been registered against the migrant worker in the under the Disaster Management Act, they have to be set aside. And they combined all the petitions that were filed in the Supreme Court and gave an order which was primarily in the interest of migrant workers. The instruction was, the direction of the court was to tell the union and the state governments to recognize the migrant workers and arrange the facilities for them to reach home safely. And when they reach home, of course, do their proper screening. Whether it happened or not, there we don't have quantitative or qualitative data to establish that, but this was the measure that was taken after June 2020 when Supreme Court gave the said order. Now we move on to the COVID-19 ramification on businesses. When we talk about businesses, of course, we know that businesses incurred huge losses during the COVID-19 pandemic. We'll be firstly focusing on the MSMEs because it is the backbone of the Indian economy. Secondly, we'll be focusing on the impact on stock markets. And lastly, we will be discussing the opportunities that have risen during the COVID pandemic and the future of those opportunities. So in the introductory part, as I mentioned, we have witnessed that the businesses have incurred huge losses, but simultaneously we have also seen a rise in certain businesses, and we will be talking about about it in further points. Firstly, we talk about the impact on MSME, the micro, small, medium enterprises, which are the backbone of the Indian economy because it contributes to around 30% of the GDP and 31% of the GVA, which basically deals with the manufacturing sector. It, of course, it generates huge employment and it deals with most of the exports of the country. So the losses incurred in the MSME sector took a huge toll on the Indian economy, primarily because most of the work of the MSME sectors was dealing with offline work and physical presence of the laborers. And due to the lockdown, of course, they could not work and the laborers have to return. And since most of the industries are labor intensive industries, they could not compensate the laborers. They could not arrange revenue for their own survival, which of course is a big reason behind why the Indian economy took a huge blow in the 2020 and currently as well in 2021. The government took a few steps regarding the MSMEs and their benefit by increasing the moratorium period of loans, by making it easy for the companies to take loans and try to create a source of finance for them as well. But the pertaining issue is that the MSME industries have complained since early 2010s that if the companies and the contribution of MSMEs in the economy has to grow, there has to be a proper source of funding, which must be organized by the government itself or a consolidated funds which can help the MSMEs to sustain for a longer period of time. Now we move on to the impact on stock market. Surprisingly, the stock market, especially the Indian stock market, has been quite resilient to COVID-19, and there hasn't been a negative impact as such in the stock market. It is expected primarily because the government has implemented policies in favor of businesses by increasing the moratorium period and easing sanctioning of loans, which is believed to have won the trust of the investors, and which has till now at least kept our stock market intact. During the COVID-19 pandemic, one of the most important things to be noticed was the younger generation had invested more in the stock markets. That is the people ranging from 24 to 35, the people that we conventionally are calling the millennials. The millennial generation took a huge participation and in the stock market during the last year. One of the primary reasons could be that there is some sort of insecurity regarding the funds, and people are looking for ways to grow their wealth, even if it comes at some sort of a risk. But for the overall economic growth, the inclusion of youth in the stock market is obviously a very good aspect. The opportunities.
What is the role of FDI in this? Don't you think the FDI has been a primary role that the stock market has not been impacted so much?
Yes. Indeed. So one of the major reasons is also that it's not like the stock market has consistently resilient. It is just that in 2021, during the second wave, we have not seen any negative impact. It could definitely be because the capital supplying countries have mostly vaccinated their people, and whether we like it or not, it plays a huge role in stabilizing the world economy as a whole. So definitely,
question is that how FDI has given a major role in the stock market, that stock market is just booming up and is consistent. How FDI is
in terms of FDI,
FDI should have been one major point in the impact of social stock market.
Yes. Indeed. Yes. However, as I mentioned earlier as well, I personally have not researched upon the quantitative aspect of the FDI as to how much FDI has increased over the period of time, especially in the last year. But certainly, as I mentioned earlier as well, the FDI and the investors have actually put their trust on the Indian government in terms that that they are increasingly following progressive policies to safeguard their business and the interest of those investors who are bringing the foreign direct investment. So certainly it plays a huge role, and the main reason that FDI has remained constant and has become the backbone as to why the stock market has remained consistent is because the trust of those investors has remained in the Indian market. I hope that answers the question, sir.
Yeah.
Of course. So we mentioned about the younger generation, which is investing more, which is definitely good in the longer run for the economy as a whole. And further, now we'll be discussing the opportunities which have risen due to in the course of the pandemic. Firstly, it is the e-learning platform and skill development. The government has certified many private e-learning platforms and given them the certificate of Skill India and all the government certifications that are possible, so that they can promote e-learning amongst the people, and in order to promote a sort of a gig economy. Gig economy is basically not a conventional job, but a remote work in which people work in small gigs and make money. You can say it is like freelancing work that we conventionally refer to. At present, the gig.
Don't you think that gig economy is usually based on the labor market, which has been categorized to that? gig economy?
At present, the gig economy, especially in India, has not grown that much. It has only seen a decline because gig economy, we see in the context of India, we have people like cab drivers, delivery boys, and like night watchmen. These are the people that are categorized in the context of India in the gig economy. We have not conventionally categorized, at least from a legal standpoint, the freelance work or let's say, if I, being a law student, take some sort of a freelance work from another country regarding contract drafting or something, that is yet not categorized anywhere in the gig economy in terms of the government, in terms of the legal framework or any of the steps the government has taken. So gig economy in the world has definitely seen a rise because they focused on skill development. But one of the reasons of how we are not able to develop that skill could be the digital divide that we have, as a huge chunk of population still does not have the access to internet properly. And those who even do have the access to internet, they don't know how to reach these platforms and the possibility that they can develop that skill and, kind of decrease their dependence on the government. So definitely this particular aspect needs to be focused on. And gig economy in the long run, as per even the research that I've done, it is good for the economy, but it requires a proper framework so that at the end of the day, they don't face exploitation, end up of exploitation from the employers, especially when the freelance work can be taken from foreign countries as well. So there has to be a sense of unity amongst the countries as well, and a framework in the domestic laws as well to protect the people who are working the gigs.
Do you think that gig economy can be a opportunity for the migrant workers and all?
Gig economy in the sense, I think it can be, but there is a problem with that aspect as well, in terms that the migrant workers, a lot of time they have kids, right? So let's say a migrant worker from UP, they go to Mumbai for some work for, let's say, 3 months. What they do at present is that they don't enroll their kids in school because they're only there for 3 months. They don't do anything productive for their kids. So what it essentially does is that it keeps them in the loop of poverty. And I think it's needless to say that it's very important for the migrant workers, especially that they send their kids to school, that the access of education is increased to their children. So that in future, of course, if their kids, they want to take a part of the gig economy, they do it in a skilled way and not in an unskilled way. So a migrant workers aspect is definitely something to be pondered about, but it has some ramifications attached to it.
Okay.
Now the conclusion is that, of course, that we have through the course of this research, we have tried to establish that the social and economic ramifications of COVID-19 are interrelated to one another, and the way forward is by looking at the ground reality, which is primarily the digital divide, the condition, the increased decline in the income of residents, and all the aspects of the absence of legal framework that is to be taken care about by the government itself. Now, these are the few suggestions that I have, which include primarily the policy framework with regards to the migrant workers, urban poor and gig workers. The urban poor, I have not mentioned about them, but the urban poor, of course, includes the roadside vendors, the maids that come to our houses, and all the poor people who live in urban slums and basically who live in urban slums, and the gig workers that we have discussed about. Enforcement of the new labor code, which was formulated by the government, which was a compression of all the 44 laws in the 4 different codes. However, of course, because it does not have a formulation of rules, it has not been completely enforced yet. So the recommendation is, of course, after the implementation and implementation of the rules, which covers the entire working class, it needs to be implemented as soon as possible. Providing support to the MSME regarding the source of financing. It is mentioned that since a decade, the MSMEs have been screaming that they need a source of financing, an easy source of financing. So a consolidated fund or a particular source of financing, even if private, needs to be created to support the MSMEs. The moratorium period and the easy loans, of course, which the government is already doing, it needs to continue to do that for a longer period of time to revive these industries. And lastly, promote the gig economy in the longer run, but promote it by teaching skills which are going to be useful in the coming times, and in some way it needs to be addressed that in the gig economy of India there are most of the people are currently unskilled workers, so that needs to be changed in the longer run by managing the digital divide, of course, by making people, and in the end, of course, making people less dependent on the government if times like these ever come again in the future. This was my presentation. Thank you very much. Sorry if I took a little more time than allotted, but
thank you so much, Karthikey. Sir, any questions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Karthikey, I think tell me one policy framework which you yourself want to make it for migrant workers. One policy framework.
For the migrant workers. So firstly, I feel that that a problem with the migrant workers is the unawareness amongst them. That they are not aware of the opportunities that might be readily available around them. So, in my personal opinion, if let's say a person, a migrant worker in UP, in east of UP, if that person gets some work in Lucknow or Allahabad or a bigger city in UP itself, it will be much easier for the migrant worker to work in their home state rather than going to states like Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, which is impossible to manage for themselves and for the government as well. So the first aspect is definitely that it is not particularly a policy suggestion, but it is more of a work to be done. But I personally feel that is the only way forward, because migrant workers are not going to be decreased. They will only increase over the period of time. And the only solution is that if they find some sort of work in their home state itself, in the bigger cities if possible, I feel in the longer run,
you bound a state government or central government for more responsibility.
We follow a federalistic structure, and I feel in this particular aspect, it is the responsibility. The more responsibility lies with the state governments. However, of course, I'm not completely holding them culpable in this, but I do feel that since we follow a federalistic structure, the states do have a particular responsibility towards their migrant workers. And yes, they hold more responsibility.
Thanks.
Shall we proceed to the next, sir?
Thank you so much.
Yeah, please.
Okay, now I would request team 25. Am I audible to you? Please proceed. Please. Yes, but not here. Please switch on your camera. Is there any technical problem?
We can move to the next if
sir. Okay, team code 25, please take your time. We are proceeding with the next team, that is team code 29. Are you ready for your presentation? Team code 29, am I audible to you?
Yes, Ekta, give me a moment. Let me ask.
Okay. Are you ready?
Yeah, she's presenting.
Okay, sure. Proceed. Please switch on your cameras.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, but you are not visible.
Oh, just a second. Now?
Yes. Please proceed. Start here.
I hope it's visible. Good morning, one and all. Good morning to one and all present here. I, Mana Sharma, and along with my friend Gayatri Avasthi, are going to talk about how the COVID has impacted our environment. So the sub-theme for our paper is to explore the environmental aspect of COVID-19. The theme of our paper is COVID-19, an umbrella for the environment. So content of our paper, and objective and research methodology. So our paper, the basic objective behind this writing this paper was to look into the impacts, both positive and negative, and that are affecting our society, that is our environment, and try to analyze which side of it is heavier and outline some possibilities to achieve a long-term environmental benefit. The research methodology that we have used is exploratory and secondary research, which was performed after reading various research papers, articles, reports, institutions and organizations, etc.
So I am going to deal with the introduction part of our research paper. So starting with the introduction, I would like to quote given by Mr. Lester Brown. He said, "We have not inherited this earth from our forefather. We have borrowed it from our children." So by this way we can understand that earth is not our property. We cannot use or exploit in our manner. So this COVID-19 has given this idea or kind of acknowledgement to save our earth, because we are not considering earth and environment at a peak level. We are just using and exploiting every raw materials, natural resources given by the earth. So this COVID-19 has given COVID-19 has make us aware about the problems which are happening in the environment and the things which we cannot protect, like in a short period of time, as the COVID-19 because of COVID-19, this lockdown has happened, and the whole, not only India, but the whole country has faced the partial or absolute lockdown. And because of that, Earth heal in itself. So the human cannot do such thing. But like, for example, in Delhi government used this odd and even concept to protect for the environment pollution, but that has not a good impact on the pollution. Now, in the Subhash Kumar versus State of Bihar, Article 21 was interpreted that the Article 21 includes the wholesome of environment, the free the environment free of pollution is the right of each and every person right of each and every person. Next.
Is it a right or fundamental duty of each and every person to protect the environment?
It's a fundamental it's a fundamental duty of every person to protect the environment.
Fundamental duties and fundamental rights go hand in hand. So basically it is both. It is because we have a fundamental right, therefore our fundamental duty also rises. Positive impacts. While dealing with the positive impacts, we'll basically talk about four major aspects of the environment, that is pollution, water, air pollution, water, noise, and wildlife. First, we'll talk about noise pollution. Noise pollution basically means when an unwanted or excessive sound that can have deleterious effect on human health, wildlife, and environmental quality. So they are produced by various man-made activities such as construction, vehicles, machines, etc. Noise pollution negatively impacts the mental health of a person. It also causes cardiovascular problems, disorders, and also human go through shortness of sleep, which directly have an impact on our survival. Therefore, in the case of free legal aid cell, cell versus government of NCT of Delhi and others, the court held that noise can be well regarded as a pollutant because it contaminates environment, causes nuisance, and affects the health of a person and would therefore offend Article 21. As per certain reports, 360 million people around the globe are prone to loss of hearing because of noise pollution. And this pandemic, in order to combat the widespread disease of this pandemic, lockdown was imposed, which forced people to stay in, and the economic activities, the mankind activities were stopped for a while, if not absolutely majorly. So due to the shutdown of the economy, there has been a lot of reduction in the noise pollution. And if we remember, in the first phase, there was like an almost absolute lockdown where marriages were not allowed, construction work was not allowed, metros did not work. And this all in countries like India, where there is a massive use, and when there is a like if marriages, India is a country which spends a lot in marriages, the overall noise pollution was reduced. In the capital of India itself, because of metro not working, areas and residents in nearby metro has actually experienced a reduction in noise pollution from 100 decibels to 50, 60 decibels, which is a lot, which a human by intention could not have done. Possibly.
Do you think metro causes noise pollution?
Metro does cause noise pollution because because it is a heavy transport, and when it runs, even railways for that matter, when it runs, if you live nearby a station, your whole house will kind of shake. So it does cause some percentage of noise pollution. It does. So next, talking about water pollution. So there has been a lot of improvement in water pollution. Supreme Court in Narmada Bachao Andolan versus Union of India has declared that water is a basic necessity for survival, and clean water is therefore the right of a human, and therefore it attracts Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. Water is one of the most essential natural resources, as we all know. A large number of water bodies, ponds, lakes, etc. are polluted due to release of effluents from human activities like factories, sugar mills, dumpings in the rivers, etc. These pollutants basically changes the water quality or intensity of the water and makes it harmful for humans as well as the animals.
Are being disposed in water. How come you are saying hundreds of bodies has been disposed in water?
Yeah, we'll be dealing with this as the negative impact.
Okay.
Sorry.
Proceed. Okay.
Yeah. Lockdown has drastically made a difference because obviously we know that factories were shut and people were not going out. So waste generation and industrial pollution, etc. Heavy addition of heavy materials and plastic to hydrosphere to different sources was reduced, and resulting in clean water and a safer water to drink. There have been evidences that water quality has actually improved, and we have seen some endangered species in the water. For example, if we talk about Italy, Grand Canal has been way much cleaner as compared to the previous years. And also the holy river of India, Ganga, has witnessed a much clearer water and is now a better place for animals to live. Air pollution. The air we breathe has a direct impact on our lives, on our health. It affects our lungs, it affects the mortality rate as well. However, in recent times, due to a lot of industrialization and a lot of motor vehicles and transportation, the quality of air has been decreased. WHO in 2016 in their report said that almost around 91% of the global population lives in an area where they are very close. They live in an area where air quality is not actually good for human health. However, during the lockdown, because the economy slowed down, movements were restricted, people did not go out, people not going were not going out for work, they did not use motor vehicles, industries did not emit their toxic gases. This all resulted in improvement of air quality. Delhi, as we all know, we were facing a lot of problems because of air pollution, and WHO also said that 8% of the total global deaths is caused due to air pollution. So coming back to Delhi, we all know how much we faced problems because of Delhi, especially in the times of late Decembers when smog and fog united. Odd even, we opted for odd even, but there was not a massive reduction somehow. However, because in this 1.5 years, the air quality across the globe has improved, and Delhi, who was rated as one of the most polluted city, has now got a good rating, which is like a safe place to live. Wildlife. Lastly, I would like to deal with wildlife, which is a very important part of the ecology. So in the Supreme Court in Sansar Chand versus State of Rajasthan, Supreme Court expressed their point of why wildlife is important. And they said that preservation of wildlife is very important for maintaining the balance in the environment and sustaining the ecological change. They also give an example that if a rabbit eats a worm, and if the rabbits are all the rabbits vanish one day, so the worms would increase in the ecology, which will ultimately have a negative impact.
Do you know how many of cats has been killed in Australia? Therefore, a lot of rats are there in Australia, and which is one of the major problems.
And also because of that, because of coronavirus in Australia also, there was a ban in eating cats, killing cats and dogs, and to stay away from them, because there was a, we can say that they might have coronavirus, or they might carry coronavirus. So China was the first country to witness the case of coronavirus, and therefore they immediately put a ban on consumption of wildlife as a precautionary measure. Even many wildlife conservation departments have said that wildlife should not be killed for consumption, and live animal market should be stopped. While this pandemic was little suffocating for humans to stay in, it was like a more playground for the animals. Many animals were seen on the streets. Many animals which were considered to be endangered were found, and it was a good time for animals to be out to play. Some endangered species that we see are gangatic dolphins, olive riddle turtles, then hawksbill sea turtles, fin whales, this gangatic dolphins in India is found after almost 30 years. And we have actually seen cavate in a district of Kerala. And there has been a lot of improvement in the wildlife. Gayatri will deal with the negative impact of coronavirus.
So after dealing with the positive impact of coronavirus, we cannot avoid the negative impact of coronavirus. So as the corona plays a vital role in the improvement of pollution and everything, it also plays a vital role in enhancing the plastic use. So I'm going to deal with the biomedical waste, where the PP kits and masks were add-on as the plastic wastage. And the other unfortunate threats, which are we are not paying concern, like the gloves, the X-ray sheets, and the containers which holds the vaccines. And the other environmental problems related to increase the death tolls. Next slide. Mana, next slide. Okay, so first I'm going to deal with the PP kits and masks. So these PP kits and masks are made of plastic, microfiber plastic. And this microfiber plastic are made up of microfibers. These microfibers, when decomposed, they convert into the nanoparticles. And this nanoparticle is very much harmful for the environment, like for air pollution also. It will infect your lungs, and this nanoplastic is also affecting the aquatic animals. Like they will enter into the bodies of the fish and other mammals of the water. And this microfibers is going to be the next cause of nanoplastic pollution. And to deal with this nanoplastic pollution, it is very challenging job for the world. So this PPE kits, the plastic use has enhanced with the industrialization and globalization. But this COVID-19, it boosts up the usage of plastic. And now the plastic usage has, per minute, we use 3 million of masks. So can you calculate the number of masks which we are using right now, and how we are going to decompose it? So this is the major problem before the world to tackle with. And I'm going to talk about the solution that I have dealt with later on in my conclusion part. So now, I'm on the next slide. So the unforeseeable threats to the environment, we are talking about the mask and the PP kits, which are very visible to us, but the things which we, the doctors and the medical staff is using, and we are not very much aware because we don't concern about, we don't put concern about it, like the X-ray sheets, because the coronavirus is infecting the lungs. And if there is a minute oxygen rate fluctuate, then we just go for the X-ray of lungs or a CT scan of lungs. So the X-ray reports are made up of plastic, the microplastic. And this microplastic is also a very much concern for the environment. Now the gloves. Gloves are made of this polymers, ester polymers, which when decomposed, they produce a lot of air and land pollution. These are also the major concern for the environmental pollution. Vaccine containers. We only take now for this case, for this research, we have taken the example of India. So in India, we know the population is about 134 crores in record, but like not record, we are not talking about it. So the record data is 134 crores. And one person needs 2 doses of vaccination. If you will produce 2 vaccinations for one person, can you just calculate the number of vaccines? Right, the number of plastics is going to be produced in upcoming year. Like it started only for the vaccination purpose. And just think about the worldwide scenario. Every country is having their own vaccination drive, and they are using the vaccines and the vaccine container, the syringe, which have been used for the vaccination, and the vaccine containers, which are used for the vaccination drive, are also the major concern for the environmental pollution. The testing kit is also made of plastic. And this testing kit, like one person needs 5 to 6 times test of corona if the person is infected. Just think about the number of plastic we are using in this scenario. Mana, next. So these are the pictures that we have collected for the like how it is in affecting the environment. Now, the pollution is the different thing right now here. But the person we are losing, the loved ones, the country and the people who are losing their loved ones, that is also a major problem. And the humanity is some or the other way I can see that it is dying. But in this scenario also, it plays a role for the environmental pollution. How this dead bodies were cremated is also lead to environmental pollution. For example, in Hindu rituals, we cremate the body by setting on it on fire. And in Muslim and the Christianity religion, the ritual is to bury the body, the land. So for that, we need land. We need wood. How we will supply the wood? We will cut down the trees. So this cut down of trees leads to two pollutions. First, the air pollution and land pollution. Like deforestation. And this air pollution, the cremation in according to Hindu ritual, setting on fire is the major issue for the air pollution. But under Article 21, the last right is a fundamental right. So we cannot avoid it. But this is one scenario that I'm going to deal in the conclusion part, that how we can reduce the air pollution by giving the last right with respectful manner. The disposal of the dead bodies in water tributaries is also a major concern because it contaminate the water bodies. This scenario is not only affecting the environment, but also the pockets of the human beings. So most people who are economically poor or they cannot afford 7,000 or 8,000 expenditure for their cremation of their loved ones, they just simply dispose the body in the water tributaries. And it is also a major concern for the water pollution. Now, Mana, next. So these are some pictures that I've collected. The water is contaminated by disposal of water bodies in the water tributaries. And the land we are, because the graveyards are almost full, so we need more and more land. And for the land, we are cutting down the trees. This is also a major concern for the land pollution. And the air pollution I have already talked about, and see the number of woods we are having in this picture. Anna, next.
Coming to the conclusion, the positive impact that the world has undergone during this time of pandemic is a clear indication that the environment wanted to heal itself and that humans could not do it to the extent it did it itself in the last 1.5 years. Mankind could not ameliorate the environment to the extent that it has done itself. However, the impact, the positive impact, is a short-term consequence, because as soon as the economy is going to come back to its work, when the life will be normal, everything will have a repercussion, as the people will be back to its activities and all the pollution which was reduced will be added on. So for that, we all need to do something about. The government should come together as a whole and take some steps for which the positive impacts of COVID-19 must be retained, and the negative impacts should be converted into positive impacts and should be used as an advantage. For example, IT companies should reduce their infrastructure. IT sector or any other sector which does not require a regular coming of people, of their employees, should schedule their attendance, or maybe call them weekly, twice a week or thrice a week or something like that. Then industry should be shut down for 2-3 days at least in a week so that the air quality and water is stabilized. Use of green and public transport, which includes bicycling, which has become like a trend in the lockdown, should actually be encouraged among the people for short distances. Green vehicles and public transport to reduce emission. It is necessary to encourage people to use public transport. Then also public bike shares, which is a concept of China, should be adopted so that the pollution reduces. Gayatri, you are muted.
So I have already talked about the pollution that is going on right now in the corona scenario. Now, how we are going to tackle with this? So this the mask and the PP kits, they are, as I have already explained, they are made up of micro fibers, and this microfiber include a polypropylene. This polypropylene can be converted into fume. This research was made by the scientists of France, where he said that this polypropylene can be converted into fuel by the polyrosis experiment. By this polyrosis experiment, the fibers are combusted into, without the help of oxygen, they converted into the fumes, and the fumes can be used for the concreting the roads, and it can also be used in many other purposes. So we can dispose of the plastic biomedical waste in this way. Secondly, the disposal of dead bodies can be done through the electrical cremation machine. And there is one more thing that the Indian use, this the cow dung cake. This cow dung cake is also used instead of wood to reduce the number of cutting down the trees, which will save the environment for a long period of time. Because if you will cut trees right now, and if you think that you will plant the tree and it will start giving you oxygen as equals to the tree which were existing, it is totally impossible. So we have to look for a solution which is temporary. It is affecting the air also, because when you will burn the cow dung, it will create the air pollution because it will produce methane gas. But it is for the short period. The air can be purified by the trees which were existing. But if you will cut down the tree, that pollution will be more harmful and long-term impact will be there. So this is the major concern that we are going to deal with. And this nanoplastic can also be used in many other applications. Like I have told you, this polyrosis process, in which this is composed into fuel, and this fuel can be used in various purposes, like furnishing the cemented roads and everything. So this is my solution for the pollution created by the medical waste, and we have to tackle with this because we cannot avoid the usage of mask and PP kit because it is for our protection. Yamana, you can.
However, Supreme Court in the case of Subhash Kumar versus State of Bihar stated that right to life also has right to wholesome environment, but that environment is something that we really need to protect. No matter how long we have traveled in a wrong direction, we always have the choice to turn around. So we must understand that it's an urgent need to heal the planet before it harms us and makes our survival difficult. There needs to be a basic change in the attitude of the people and towards their environment and surroundings. Thank you.
So I will conclude this whole research by stating a quote. be a part of solution, not the part of pollution. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Gayatri and Nana. I would request sir, if he has any questions to ask.
Yeah, it was a good presentation. And my question to you both is, give me one step each that how will you aware the vulnerable section of society about the environment?
Sorry, can you repeat the last line, sir?
Give me one step. How will you aware the vulnerable sections of society regarding environment?
So, sir, this is a big problem before us because already the media and this Modi ji ki man ki baat is...
How will you aware?
Sir, in this scenario, as I was an individual person and I have some responsibility towards the society. So initially I was thinking to, but like the people who are not aware about the picker, the garbage picker at my home who come. So I used to tell them, don't put the garbage like this, put your gloves on your hands, at least like, and wash it and then use again. So I at my level, how can I improve? Like making people aware by small little things, and the small efforts like pays you a lot. So you cannot say that you start doing this, and when the chain will create, then definitely it will turn into a better solution. This is my solution.
For me, I guess charity begins at home. So getting this emotion of conserving the environment, teaching this to, not exactly teaching, but explaining how bad this situation has come out to be. Telling our parents, our family members not to dispose of the gloves that we use every day or the mask, the disposable, so that the bird or the dog outside your house has it in its mouth. So taking small steps, not using polythenes for small things at house, this might, I guess, make a difference. Each one teach one kind of situation if it comes to.
Okay. Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Thank you.
Yeah, Ekta, please, person.
Thank you so much, Mana and Gayatri. And now I would request TC25 to kindly share their screen and present their presentation. Am I audible to you?
Yeah.
Is your network connection fine now?
Yeah.
Okay, please start.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, it's visible. But I think you are not visible. So, is she visible to you? Yes, now you are visible.
The moment to one of our presentation, I am checking this enough. From second year Delhi Metropolitan Education. My theme is lockdown impact on air quality and right to pollution free air before and after the COVID-19. Introduction. Before starting introduction, I will be briefing out the objective of my research paper. Basically, I have written the research paper to get knowledge about how does the this pandemic has affected the air quality and the quality of our lives. The introduction to my presentation is briefing upon clean air and air, difference between clean air and air pollution, reasons for the air pollution, impact of COVID-19 on air pollution, clean air. And the clean air, basically talking about, before talking about the clean air and air pollution, I would like to speak up a quote. Air is what air pollution is. This quote is enough to shortly explain what is the importance of clean air and the harm of air pollution on our lives. Basically, air refers to the clear gas which we inhale and which gives our life, which leads our life to a healthier
I can't hear her well. She can close her video and then she can speak. I don't need her visibility. I just need her voice. That's all.
I think, did you hear this, sir?
Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. Just turn off your camera because it is degrading the quality of your voice.
Yeah.
So I need to understand what you're speaking.
Air refers to the atmosphere of the earth, which gives us a clear gas that helps us to lead a healthy life. A clean air, it contains approximately 78% of nitrogen, 21% of oxygen, and a small amount of other gases, with 1% of water vapor. Now I will be telling about the air pollution. Air pollution is basically a mixture of harmful gases that harms our healthy life. It is the air pollution basically consists of smoke, carbon dioxide, sulfur, nitrogen, and other harmful gases which leads our life to a chronic and very harmful diseases. Reasons for air pollution. The basic reasons for air pollution are burning of fossil fuels, industrial emission, indoor air pollution, wildlife or forest fires, transportation, agricultural activities, and open burning of garbage waste. Basically, the burning of fossil fuels affects the quality of life through the moving of vehicles, the operation.
Sorry to interrupt, Tripti. Please, can you just put your mic? Tripti, am I audible to you?
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. Can you please put your mic close to your mouth? We are not able to understand it properly.
Am I audible now?
You are audible, but the clarity is not so good.
Okay. Am I clear now?
Sir, is it fine?
Let it be.
Okay. Please try to be much clearer.
Okay.
Proceed.
So, basically, the burning of fossil fuels helps us to produce energy for transportation and electricity that we need for the development of the country. The toxic gases that are released due to the burning of fossil fuels are impacting the ability of our heart to pump enough oxygen, and due to this, we face major chronic diseases and respiratory diseases. Industrial emission is one of the basic reasons that affects the air quality. The developing countries always need an industry that helps us to increase our economic basis. The harmful gases that are released by these industries are nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, carbon monoxide, and other chemical fuel gases that affects the air quality and helps in developing of nations. But the effect after these harmful gases, when they mix up with the air, is leading our irritation and sore throat, itching of our eyes, and other respiratory distresses. Indoor pollution. The use of many chemical filled products in the house leads to the indoor pollution that are toxic, but we need to use it. Sometimes the use of like when we in the season of summer, we use air conditioners or other cooling machines like coolers, which increases the humidity, and it also leads in some or other way to the air pollution in the indoor, whether it is our houses, whether it is our schools or any other area. Wildfire or forest fire. Forest fire the high spike in the temperatures due to these air pollution, the ozone layer has brought up the spike, which allows the UV rays to enter the earth, and now which sometimes leads to the forest fires. Transportation. We all know that transportation helps us to the major contribution of air pollution. Especially in urban cities, where we use our own private vehicles to move from one place to another. Agricultural activities also has an impact on our air pollution. The agricultural activities has
Your voice is not audible. PC25. Much better. Can you just improve the quality?
Actually, I'm trying to improve the quality. I'm really sorry for interrupting.
It's fine. Okay, proceed, please.
Yeah, the use of tractors, pesticides and fertilizers are increasing the
Again, you are not audible.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Actually shifted the wire. That is maybe it is.
Can you try to conclude it a bit early because your voice is breaking up so much?
Yeah.
Okay, please do so.
Can I proceed to the conclusion?
Just brief it.
Yeah, you can.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Basically, the conclusion to my content is that the world should take this collaborative initiative towards the air pollution so that in the future it helps us. As of now, we see that due to the COVID-19, all the economic activities have stopped, and now when it will restart, when the life will come to the normal phase, the world will be again facing the air pollution. So the world should take collaborative initiative, or they may take individual initiative to control for planning and controlling the air pollution. The incident of forest fires and open burning of dumped waste and other reasons for air pollution should be managed by the government. This the last point that I would be concluding is the deadly virus has a major impact on the lives of the people and has killed their loved ones, which has affected, but it has not only affected this, it has also affected the economy of overall the country. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Any questions?
Yeah, I can't hear her properly, but still, she can tell me that what will be her suggestion to the government if she want to curb this air pollution in this way. In this, she can hear me, right?
Yeah, so I can hear you.
Yeah. So what will be your effect? Yes.
So basically, I personally will be advising the government to take some measures like providing. Today we have technological advancements. So I would like that now the air quality has been improved with, from the before times that we have faced till 2019. So, and the increasing air quality has somewhat. Cover up the ozone layer, the spikes in the ozone layer. So it will help the atmosphere to stop the UV rays that come from the sun. So it will stop the forest fires or the other types of fires that are taking place. And other, on the other side, I would be suggesting that the government should give some technological use some technological advancement for the farmers so that they should not burn out the residue that they have after cutting, after harvesting the agricultural crops we use. So they burn out the residue that they have after to cover up their fields, fertilize their fields again. So I would be suggesting this though.
Okay. Thank you. That's great. Yeah.
I would like to thank all the participants for participating and presenting well in context to the topic that you provided. So this event was basically initiated by CCHR and DME Research Cell in collaboration with the DME Eco Club. If the sir is ready, sir, can we have your feedback and can we start the valedictory session?
Yeah, I am always ready to speak anything in front of students because it is something which has been very much connected to my heart. Right. See, I am also, yeah. See, you're always a student. Even if you are practicing, or even if you have reached anywhere in your life, we are always a student, right? So, see, this pandemic time have been like opportunity in a disaster, right? So, this digital learning is very much affordable. This is a new innovation, and this is something which is very much connected to each other. And this is something like the seminars and all the competitions which is going on online. This is something like everybody can do it from their home. They don't have to come to the college, or they have to invest their time traveling and all. They can sit at home, they can research, and they can come up with their best. See, what I feel, the paper which were presented, they were more good. They were There were a lot of issues regarding the digital learning, business, migrant workers, air pollution, environmental aspects and all. But I think the most important paper, what can be there for a law student would be the role of judiciary in this pandemic time, that how the justice delivery system has been affordable, how the justice system is very much digitalized and can reach the any part and any section of society so easily. What was the role of judiciary in implementing the policies? How the judiciary has come up with all this, the corona crisis, and they have come up for the oxygen delivery to, you can also file a writ for getting vaccinated and all those things. So there is a lot of issue which has, and a lot of really positive issue, which has come up for judiciary and for law students, because law students has come up and they have filed the PILs regarding this, all the corona crisis and all. So this is an opportunity for all of us. This is a very unprecedented time. This time was never before, and I hope we cannot imagine this time coming up afterwards also, because once this pandemic is over, I don't think that anything will be coming up afterwards, because we all will be prepared. I think for the medical facility, it was for medical infrastructure, it was eye-opening. I think it was something like, we can compare the Ayurveda and we can compare the allopathy together in this present scenario, because drinking bloy to having a paracetamol, everything was important. So this has really, really come up with a new structure of living. This has really come up with a new structure of de-stabilizing and de-hygiening yourself. That how come you can save yourself in this corona time, and how hygiene is important. And I think, see, we as a nation of like more than 130 crore people, like one of the participants have said, more than 134 crores. So it is not easy, right, to come up with everything what the public demands. We have a huge reserve which is limited and which is capable, but the reach out of those reserves is quite impossible because of the not of so much modern amenities and the equipments which has come up in this era. So I think this paper presentation, which was related to the environment, which was related to the basic structure what we need in this corona time, was one of the best things I had. And everybody has really worked very hard. All the audiences have heard it very patiently. It is never easy to be online and just hear everything what is going on, because even I have not did it in my college life. And like, see, you know, I think this like the innovation of coming up with something, how can we help in the stock market, how this digital learning has helped, how we can just improve the air pollution. I think everything is very much important when you come up, and we come up together to help this corona crisis and to come up with it. So it is very courageous to do this, and I really congratulate each and everyone for this. Thank you for having me. And yes, I am out of town. That is the reason you cannot see me well, right? I am also there in Hisar. I came up for some work, and then therefore I'm stuck here. So yeah, thanks for this.
Thank you so much for overwhelming words, sir. Do we have the results ready at your part?
Yeah, I have already done all my part when I was hearing it. Yeah, so do you want me to announce the results right now itself?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yeah, see, so for me, like, nobody is a winner or a loser. Everybody is a competitor. And for me, see, it is not the best who won. It is the circumstances and the preparation of the best who won, and you can also do it. So nobody has to lose the heart and all. And so my, the best speaker would be the team C19 boy, team C19, and the best paper was this team code 29 paper, because they have really worked hard. Even team code 2 paper was also very good. They have innovated a lot of things in affordable learning, digital learning and all. But I think the team 29 girls have really worked hard to prepare a good and innovative session, because we can see something while we are speaking, because just only speaking get everybody bored a lot. So team 29,
kindly switch on your cameras, the winners. Congratulations to you.
Thank
you, sir.
Yeah, and
thank you, sir.
You worked hard, and everybody has worked hard. Even team 25 has worked hard. She's sitting somewhere she's just trying to get us connected. So everybody has really worked hard. And team 25, team 29, team 19, team 02, congratulations to reach the final round. It's a win for you all, because you have been better from many of them. But you, this is something, a part of learning, right? So keep learning. We are also learning day by day, and you are a budding lawyer. So when you come in ground, then the ground realities are very much different what you are having in the college life. So let's see how it goes. All the best to you all. And this was my reception.
Thank you so much, sir, for blessing us. I would request Navjot Suri ma'am to please give a vote of thanks to the judge.
I hope I'm audible and visible.
Yes, ma'am.
First of all, I'm really happy. I want all the participants and our special guest to know that this has been one of the best event in DME, wherein it has been run entirely by the students. We have been there just to guide them. Otherwise, managing everything has been done all by the student team. So I am very happy, and it is a great honor and privilege for me to propose the vote of thanks on this occasion. First and foremost, I want to thank our special guest, Advocate Kushal Kumar sir, who despite of his busy schedule has found time to grace this event and always agreed to me whenever I've invited him for judging some moot court or maybe for some webinar. So there has been a long connection with DME, association with DME now, with Advocate Kushal sir. So my heartfelt thanks to Mr. Gunjan Agrari for his support, a member of Center for Constitutional Law and Human Rights. Also, I thank our Vice Chairman, sir, Director DME, HOA DME Law School, Head Research Cell, for their unstinted support for this event. I owe a special gratitude to student team, student convener Ekta Gupta, student co-convener Manish, OC members Niharika, Akshat Agarwal, Deeksha, and support also given by Himanshi. Last but not the least, I thank all the participants for making this event a resounding success today, and has happened only by your support. So finally, I leave you by this inspiring quote given by Martin Luther King. An individual has not started living until he rises above the confines of his individualistic concerns to the broader concerns of all humanities. Once again, I thank you all for your kind attention, and I wish all the best to the student team. And I think that soon we are going to conduct a few more events like this. That's all from my side. The collaboration between DME Eco Club and CCHR has been a great collaboration. And I think in future we can have more such collaborations, and we can have more innovative topics the way we had this time for the future events. Thank you all.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your kind words. Obviously, we cannot take physical photographs, but I would request everyone to please switch on their videos so that we can take a virtual photograph or a screenshot for our memory.
This is also part of innovation, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please kindly switch on your cameras, everybody.
You know, can I say something? I really want to say something. I can't stop myself. After so long, I'm seeing smiling faces. I'm getting a little emotion. I don't know. Emotional because after so long, I'm seeing these smiling faces. I really wish I can see you in the classes. Tired of hearing a lot of bad news from the students losing their parents. And it has been a very tough time, I know. And I'm really happy seeing all you happy. I want that all you should stay like this and stay happy and take care of your parents, grandparents.
Yeah, and you know what? Everybody needs to be stay optimistic, right? You cannot just sit at home and you just criticize and just play with your mental health. Yeah. So be optimistic, think good. And everything will be over soon and we'll be coming to the physical world very soon. Yeah. But yes, digital world has also helped us a lot.
Yes. A lot. So let's have a photograph with you all are smiling.
Okay, let me just take a picture. Everybody, please smile. Yes, taken. Thank you so much all for participating here. We are very overwhelmed from the response. We are very happy for having sir with us today. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, Gunjan, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you everybody for participating and making this event successful. And that's it for today.
Thank you. So have much, a great sir. Evening. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.